binary somewhere that is used for building, but it really always builds itself based on itself. And all that is on a base of basically 100 packages that are used for bootstrapping. So you can start the whole distribution with just a set of 100 packages. That makes it quite easy to, for example, port to different architectures, because you just need to start with those 100. Reproducible in the sense that the sources you have in OBS are the recipes to build the package. No local hacks by any developer. No binaries uploaded somewhere. We know all packages in Leap or in Tumbleweed built. So at the end of the development, really all packages were green. All of them were built with all the packages that are in the project. That is something not all other distributions managed to do. And of course, we had tons of rebuilds. So when other distributions struggle to get a rebuild done in half a year, we do that almost every day. All those 11,000. Yeah, what's new in Leap 15? As I said, 11,000 source packages. That is about 1,500 more than in 4203. All of them built in this project, all of them integrated. That is quite an achievement. We have the return of the live images, finally. So there are KDE and GNOME, as well as a rescue CD now. So if you dare to install Leap 15 so far on your hardware, please go ahead and try the live images. Yeah, when you install it, you will notice the new look first. Of course, thanks to Stasek for that. Great work there. And the new partitioner in Yast. So it does an even better proposal now, hopefully, to not screw up your partitioning. Then the distribution is mostly ported to Python 3. The core packages from SLES are basically Python 2.3, but for all the rest, that was not doable completely in that time frame. Nevertheless, I mentioned it here because if you plan to deploy Leap 15 and have custom software there, please keep in mind that Python 2 will run out of upstream maintenance soon. So it's about time to port your software to Python 3 finally. I doubt that Python 2 will really go away during the lifetime of Leap 15. Nevertheless, you should go to Python 3. Then more on the deep technical details. The repo data is now in RPMMD format. Only the old SUSE text format is gone. Why do I mention that? The translators were hit by that a bit because all the old tooling around translations of repo-related data was based on the old format, so the tools had to be ported to RPMMD, and it's not completely done yet. So there's still some glitches with the translations. Yeah, for the admins, more interesting, SUSE Firewall is deprecated and will be replaced by FirewallD. By default, you will get FirewallD. If you do an upgrade to Leap 15, SUSE Firewall is still around. There's a migration script that tries to migrate all your rules, but naturally, especially if you have custom rules, that will not be possible completely. SUSE Firewall is already not in Leap 15 anymore, I think, or at least it's considered legacy. So also, if you migrate to Leap 15, go for FirewallD in the long run. SUSE Firewall might go away over time. Yeah, on the desktop side, GNOME uses Wayland by default. There are quite some GNOME guys in the audience, I think, so if you want to know what's so great about Wayland, talk to them. It's the default now. For those where it doesn't work, there's still an X11 option. KDE also works with Wayland, but the X11 option is the default. Then a word about high DPI support. Leap 15 does support high DPI setups. So high DPI means screens that have a higher resolution than full HD, for example, 4K displays. We do support that. KDE and GNOME support it. Even Yast supports it. But it doesn't work fully out of the box. So please check the release notes. If you have such a display and can't read anything, you have to turn a few knobs and then it works. And another option in the installer that deserves special attention is the transactional update mode. It's kind of a highlight. So I want to give it a separate slide here. It's a technology borrowed from Cubic and Casp. It's basically the same as a regular server installation, so the server option you know in the installer, with the difference that it has a read-only root file system. So you're not actually supposed to install packages in that live system anymore. Nevertheless, you can install updates. Under the hood, it actually uses existing technology like Snapper and Zipper to manage snapshots. But when installing updates, instead of modifying your live system, it creates a new snapshot and installs all the updates into that new snapshot. And all you have to do is to just reboot, and you get a system that is fully updated. Other attempts to do something similar were, for example, the offline update technology that we never adopted in Leap because I didn't like it, even though others pushed for it. So with offline updates, the system basically downloads all the updates and then installs them on shutdown or on the next boot. That means your boot gets delayed in a moment where you don't want it. Like when you prepare your slides the last moment before the conference, try to shut down, and then it installs updates. I mean, that sucks, so we never did that. Instead, we have this transactional mode now, where it really just does a reboot. Yeah, and that is so reliable that it actually installs the updates by default automatically. So if you choose this option, there's a timer that installs the updates when there are some available, and it even reboots automatically, I hope at night. And you can manage that with the reboot manager, so it's configurable. There will be a separate talk for this topic by Ignaz, I think tomorrow. Yeah. So if you want to know more about that and the tools involved and the technology, please attend that talk. It's a pretty exciting technology that may also be beneficial to Tumbleweed in the long run. Okay, one of the main topic for Leap 15 is the headline Build to Scale. What does that mean? As I said, we don't really focus on a specific use case, but instead you can do almost anything with that. So from the traditional installation that you know with Yast, you just put the DVD or the USB stick in your laptop, install a single machine that is still handled very well. But you can also do mass deployments. So if you finished your installation, you can clone what you did with the AutoYast profile and then put in a Pixie server and just deploy thousands of servers. So it scales from a single system to hundreds to thousands of servers just fine. Leap uses RPM packages for better and worse. We have them quite fine-grained, so you can build a system that has quite a lot of software in there. You can also build systems that are quite small, because, for example, with the shared library packaging policies, we don't always pull the full software in, but only the libraries that you need. That is quite helpful if you build custom appliances using Kiwi, for example. So you can craft the system just like you want it for your use case. You can deploy that in the cloud or in containers just fine without using any different deployment technology. Just the existing tools will work for that with the standard Leap packages. And of course, Leap will run on physical machines just as well as on virtual environments. But that is only the technical side. What's exciting for professional users and users that use Leap in production is there's also business-wise build to scale in there, and that is a migration path to SLE. So for the first time, for OpenSUSE, SUSE supports migrating from an OpenSUSE system to SLES by means of typing Zipper, basically. So if you have a production system and you're a consultant, and for some reason you discover that you need support, you need someone to call on the phone if you have problems, and figure out that you want to go for a paid Linux offering, you're usually stuck, but not with Leap 15 anymore. You can really go, call SUSE sales, get a SUSE Linux Enterprise subscription. You can install SUSE Connect from the repo, register your Leap system as SLE 15, and then basically super dub, reboot, and your system is SLES, and your software keeps running. Of course, there's a footnote to that, because Leap has 11,000 packages and SLE only 3,000, so that will only work if you have the set from SLES, which means the server installation. However, that is not the end, because there's still Package Hub. So if you have a package in Leap that you miss in SLES, you can submit it to the SUSE Linux Package Hub, and then the package is also available for SLES without actually invalidating your support or subscription there. Yeah, that's basically what I wanted to say about Leap 15. But before you cheer for me, I want to know who actually helped making Leap 15 a great release. So this is a little exercise for the audience. I want anyone who tested Leap during the beta phase, during the milestones, to stand up. Stand up, please, if you installed a beta version of Leap or any milestone before. Oh, quite some. And who maintains a package in Leap? Who is a package maintainer? Please stand up too. The others can keep standing. Who filed a bug for Leap 15? Yeah, you can keep standing. Who fixed a bug? Also stand up. Who did some translation to Leap 15? Yeah, well, stand up. Who contributed to the wiki and wrote some articles? Stand up. Okay, so those are the guys that made Leap 15 a great release. It wasn't actually me. I just put the timeline and you had to work for me. So please give an applause to all the guys that helped make Leap 15 a great release. Okay, so I guess we're a bit early, huh? So now time to actually put the thing out. Let's see if it works. So that is live. And to Christian's disappointment, is not with salt. Let's see if that works. Maybe I should still clone my display so I can see what I type. So if you have your laptop there, I see quite some people staring at their laptop. I hope you're looking at the download server, desperately waiting for the Leap 15 ISO to appear. Let's see if I can make that happen. So that is the system that the Apache config Christian was talking about. And that is basically what prevents the final ISO on the download server at the moment. So I just removed that rule. Restart. Reload should work, right? So anyone has the download open? Is it there? See no confirmation? Yeah, that pretty much looks like the final ISO. So, I would say, Leap 15 is on the download server, easy as that. Hey! There's one bit missing, that is software.openSUSE.org, but that will auto-deploy in 7 minutes. If not, talk to me, then let's see if we can get that fixed too. Okay. So, any questions? Yeah, we'll fix that when I'm off the stage. Nah. It's not with salt. Oh, I better don't do mistakes there. Okay. If there are no more questions. Yeah, well, we're early. We also managed to release Leap before Slash 15, so we can be 5 minutes early. Okay, so with the press of this button, I hope the download server will not break. I don't know where those wires go. Okay, so let's say Leap is released. Thank you. Enjoy Leap.